Praise God. Are you glad to be here this morning? So glad that you're here with us on Super Bowl Sunday. We're having what we call Super Sunday. We hope you made plans to stay with us afterwards for a tailgate party. We're going to have hot dogs and hamburgers for you. Just a good time for the big game tonight. So we do have some Falcons fans in here, so please, no rioting, no beating up. That makes it sound like a bullet for the Patriots, and it's just not right either. So, we're glad that you're here. Are you ready to worship? About 30% of people. Are y'all ready to worship today? Praise God. Let's all stand together. Let's ask the Lord to be here with us this morning. Ask the Holy Spirit to move in the house today. Would you go ahead and just pray with me right where you are? Father, we thank you so much for who you are, God. Thank you for the opportunity to be with you this morning, God, a time where we can feel us in you, and we can experience the anointing power of the Holy Spirit, God, as we move through this service, as we flow with your Spirit. God, I pray the hearts and lives be changed. God, for one that doesn't know you this morning, I pray the gospel will be presented. God, for the one that's struggling this morning, I pray that the one who needs to hear it this morning will be encouraged. God, that we'll all hear change and have a breakthrough and deliverance, Father, in this situation. God, we thank you for your grace, what you're doing in this place today. We come today with a heart of expectation. A heart of expectation for you to do what you say that you will do. God, that you will bind the brokenhearted, that you will heal the wounded. Father, we thank you this morning because we know that you will save the lost. God, that you shine light where there's darkness. And today, more than anything, Father, we pray that you be lifted up, Father. Our lives are nothing but vessels for your glory. So today, Father, I pray that you be glorified in all that we do. In the precious and holy name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Thank you. Oh, Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, so worthy of all the glory, all the honor, all the praise. When I think about the Lord, how He saved me, how He raised me, how He filled me with the Holy Ghost, how He healed me to the uttermost. When I think about the Lord, He picks me up, He turns me around, how He placed my feet on solid ground. Thank you.
shout. I'm not talking about a shout where he did some small little thing for me. Revival, renewal, awakening, it comes with a sound. Look, you know somebody's at the door when you hear somebody knocking. Revival is always accompanied with a sound. Awakening, miracles, blessing, it's always accompanied by a sound. There's some people in here today that need to make a sound unto the Lord. You need to make a joyful noise unto the Lord. Some of y'all need a miracle in here right now, and you need to begin to make a joyful noise unto the Lord. I don't care what I'm going through. I'm going to make a joyful noise. I don't care how bad I feel this morning. I'm going to make a joyful noise. Come on, Holy Ghost. I don't care what's going on in my home this morning. I'm going to make a joyful noise unto the Lord. Does somebody know what I'm talking about? So with everything within you this morning, let's sing that one more time. And I want somebody to lift up a joyful shout unto God in this place. Come on and sing it. How He saved me. How He raised me. How He healed me. In the Holy Ghost. How He healed me. Oh,
something came back in my mind, and I said this to you before. And as long as you're speaking the language of the devil, he's okay with you. As long as you're speaking bondage, as long as you're participating in bondage, and being bound down and oppressed and having burdens on you, he's all right. But I just believe this morning that God has equipped somebody in here to speak the language of freedom. When we lift our hands to God, it's a sign of surrender. We don't do it for show. We don't do it because we're Church of God. We don't do it just because we're Pentecostal. We do it because we're expressing the fact that, God, I surrender everything that I've got to you. It's a sign of freedom. It's a sign that says, God, I lift everything I've got up to you this morning. I'm heavy-hearted. I'm heavy-handed. But, God, this morning, I'm going to lift my hand as a sign, God, that no matter what the enemy throws at me, I'm going to do whatever it takes. I'm going to do whatever it takes. I'm going to do whatever it takes. If by any means I might see you in my situation, oh, God, somebody needs to lift their hands as a sign of freedom today. He's all right with you as long as you're talking to pressing, as long as you're talking. Like you've got something binding you up and pushing you down and holding you up and whatever it is that God's put on your life. But today God's looking for a generation that'll lift up their hands in the middle of their crisis. They'll lift up their hands in the middle of their bondage. And they'll say, I'm free because this is where the Spirit of the Lord is. There is liberty. And he who the Son set free is free indeed. And I've been made free again. Go ahead and take that moment. Speak freedom, 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 freedom. I feel it lifted off of somebody this morning. I feel somebody releasing it this morning. I feel somebody letting go of it this morning. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Signs of freedom. Reminded in the book of Acts, it tells me the times of refreshing shall come from the Lord. That at the outset of the church, the book that was dedicated to establish the Church of Jesus Christ, there was a reminder in there that said the times of refreshing shall come from the Lord. It won't be finances. It won't be the paycheck showing up in the mailbox. It won't be your kids finally acting right. It won't be this, that, or the other. You can have everything right. You can be living the dream life. But if you ain't got Jesus, times of refreshing will not come. Why do we go to church? We don't come to church for a social club. We're going to have fun after service today. It's going to be great. We're going to have cornhole. We're going to have all kinds of great things. But look, we come to church because we need a time of refreshing. Because when I leave out of this place, I know that the very moment my foot steps across the threshold, that threshold is a symbol that I am going back out onto the battlefield. That threshold is a sign that the enemy is waiting at the door for me to walk with me and tell me that I can't do it, that there's nothing in this world that I can do right, that I don't have enough, that I can't be enough, that I'll never measure up. Some of you, he's walking with you as soon as you step out of this threshold, and it's all fine and good when you're in here and you're worshiping with your brothers and sisters, but you walk out and you feel alone, you feel lonely, and like nobody cares. But I've come to tell you today, this threshold you're about to cross today, I just believe that somebody's about to cross another threshold today. That when the Bible says that you can enter boldly into the throne room of grace, somebody's about to get breakthrough in this place today. If you will submit to what God is trying to tell you today, you're going to get breakthrough in whatever area it is that you need to cross that threshold of. Do you believe it? Say amen. No, do you believe it? Shout amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, worship team. I'm going to let them get to their seats, but I want you to go ahead and put up Philippians chapter 3 for me. While they're doing that, while they're making their way to their seat, can you see that? I just want to say I'm thankful for pioneers of the faith, number one. I want to say that I'm thankful for people who are faithful in commitment and covenant relationship. I am honored to sit in the presence of two godly people this morning that seek after God with all their heart. Brother and Sister Jane and Gene McAnulty are celebrating today on Superbowl Sunday their 62nd wedding anniversary. Somebody said that's a kind-hearted woman and a man with a lot of patience. All the married couples in the room say amen. Philippians chapter 3, verses 12 through 14. Y'all ready for the word? Got a couple of you. Y'all ready for the word this morning? Paul writes and he tells us, not that I've already attained or am already perfected, but I press on that I may lay hold of that for which Christ Jesus has also laid hold of me. Brethren, I don't count myself to have apprehended, but one thing I do, get this, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward. Some verses say straining forward or pressing forward to those things which are ahead of me. Verse 14, I press toward the goal of the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. How many of you know if you're going to get to the goal, it's going to take some pressing? Now I'm going to take a chance right here and tell you my message title. My message title today is Keep Pounding. About half the room likes it. I know. The message title today is Keep Pounding. We're going to need the Holy Spirit for this one. So will you ask God to send the Holy Spirit be with us today? Father, I thank you for the opportunity to preach your gospel, to preach your word, to preach your message. As God, by whatever title, whatever comparison I can make by the glory of Jesus Christ this morning, Father, I pray that you would strip away every prideful tendency in my spirit. God, that you would strip away every part of me, God, so that I can preach vulnerable and I can preach unlimited to you. God, that I can present the word of God like I've never presented it before. God, give me the anointing that makes preaching effective. God, not in and of myself, but God, I know that it comes from you. And Father, I pray for this congregation today that you would touch every heart, that you would touch every ear, God, to hear what thus saith the Lord to them this morning. God, as the words leave my mouth, God, let it be breath of life into the bodies of those who need deliverance, who need a helping hand, who need a word of encouragement this morning. God, I pray that you would rapture us, rapture our hearts, God. That you would capture us this morning, captivate us, arrest us where we are, Father. Hold us for a moment, God, and just tell us what you would have us to hear and direct our paths as we leave out of this place today, God. I know you'll do it. We ask you in Jesus' name. So in Jesus' name, everybody said, amen. Amen. You can be seated in the presence of the Lord this morning. I know it's a different kind of Sunday. I feel weird up here in a t-shirt. I'm refraining from taking my jacket off because it's a different kind of jacket anyway. But I'm refraining because I just feel weird in just a straight t-shirt up here. I'm laid back, but I'm not that laid back. You know what I mean? But Superbowl Sunday. It's a big Sunday. It's an enjoyable Sunday. Maybe more for husbands than it is wives, for men than it is women's. Women, I don't know. Women's. More than it is for men than it is women, except for my mom. My dad will call me every now and then, and he'll be just laughing. I'll say, "What's so funny?" He said, "Your mom's sitting here talking football to me." She had to become a fan because when I was in high school, I played football. We grew up in the kind of town, and Michael can attest to this. I grew up in God's country, not him, over in Swain County. But I grew up over in Murphy, North Carolina, and we had a small town feel to us. On Friday nights, the town would shut down. You could ride by some stores and be like, it'd say, close down for the game. You know, they'd be heading over to the hill. That's what we called it. Our high school, we were right in the dead middle of the mountains. We were actually in a valley, but the school set on where the mountain was coming down. And so the school sits on top of the hill, and the hill comes down into the football field. So our stadium's called the Hill. And I have a lot of great memories there. It shaped a lot of who I am here in and experience and all that I did, and it was a really good thing for me growing up being in team sports. It kept me out of a lot of trouble, right? And it just kept me busy, but it taught me a lot in life. And when I think Murphy Bulldogs, I see black and gold. Concord Spiders, calm down. It's a different kind of black and gold. But I see black and gold, but I remember a lot of tradition. I remember a legacy, and that legacy was pushed into us as kids coming up through ninth to 12th grade. That legacy was pushed to us. They had a lot of traditions that we would go through and things that, you know, we thought might bring us good luck if we did it. We had a bulldog at the top of the hill. Everybody had to touch before you went down. You know, I mean, some of y'all that play sports, maybe you know what I'm talking about. You had those little things that you did that was kind of your ritual, that was kind of your routine on your way out to what we call the battlefield. And we'd go to war out there, and we would stand together with people that we spent a lot of time with, right? But before we'd go out there, there was always this thing that happened, this really cool thing that I enjoyed just as much, I think, as I did playing the game of football, was gathering around with the rest of my teammates, and we would have, when I was a freshman, this was the coolest thing ever. The seniors would get everybody pumped up, you know. We'd get in a huddle around them, and they'd give these big motivational, inspirational speeches, and it was almost like this expectation that when you get to be a senior, you get to be the guy in the middle of the circle pumping everybody up, inspiring everybody to go down and do what they needed to do, to come together. There was a sense of camaraderie. There was a sense of camaraderie that I have a hard time finding anywhere in my life today. Maybe some of you, or maybe a lot of you, don't connect with that. Maybe some of you do, but I can remember feeling like I could go to those guys with anything, and they would help me through whatever I was going through, some of them. But as a team, I knew that when I walked out onto the field, we had prepared all week, we had worked all week, we had sweated all week, we had just went to the grind every single day with one another for hours a day to prepare for just a couple of hours on a Friday night. So that when we got into the middle of this war we were about to have come 7:30 on Friday night, that we would know that we have each other's back. We had this tradition that a pastor in our area, he was the chaplain for our team, and he'd come and he would say, "Hold the rope." And that was established because he said, "I want you to pretend like your teammates are hanging over a cliff, and it's your job to hold the rope that they're hanging on to. And you need to fight with everything that you can. You need to do everything that you can to keep them from falling. You need to be their strength when they're weak. You need to come behind them and help them whenever they need you." And a common theme in these speeches and these motivations that we tried to give one another was that of persistence and perseverance. And without being too much about football today, I use that as an illustration, and it's a good life lesson, and it's a good Christ-following lesson that you will endure times of trouble, and there will be moments in your life that require persistence and perseverance. Amen? Has anybody been there this morning? So that was my hometown. That's what I grew up in. And whether it was this sense of small town pride, or if it was just generation to generation passing down this idea that in this life you're going to have troubles, and you better just embrace the fact that troubles are going to come, and you have to persevere if you're going to do anything with your life. I don't know what it was, but it's always stuck with me. And no matter what's come my way, I have been fortunate enough to have people who are around me to help me through ages and stages of my life, to bring some kind of camaraderie to my life and help me to persist and persevere through the troubles that I go through. I'm thankful for people like that. But I look at Philippians chapter 3. If you'll throw up verse 13 for me, I'm going to try to get into the meat of what I want to talk to you about today. It says, "Brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended." Now, I want you to remember back to last week that Paul, he said that we're working to attain the resurrection. That I want to know him in his resurrection and in the fellowship of his sufferings, being conformed to his death. Now, that sounds painful, right? I want to be in a fellowship of his sufferings. I want to be conformed to his death. I want to know him in his resurrection. So, and I go through the sufferings. I'm conformed to his death so that I might attain the resurrection. Not just know it, but experience it. That when one day Jesus is still going to come back, his foot still will touch the earth after he raptures the church, and he will reign supreme as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Do you still believe it today? That when he does that, when he calls us home, that I will attain the resurrection. Not just knowing it as a head knowledge, but experiencing it in every part of my being. But then he comes back and he says, "Brethren, I don't count myself to have apprehended. I don't count myself, I'm not sitting here saying that I've obtained it already. But one thing that I do know that I have been able to obtain, one thing that I do know that I have been able to do is forget those things which are behind and reach forward to those things which are ahead." In short, this is what Paul's saying. Paul is saying the past is in the past. You need to leave it there. The football season's coming to a close now, and I am more than happy to leave the Panthers season where it is this year. Somebody say amen. Come on, help me out here. That should have got everybody, because even if you're not a Panthers fan, they were terrible. But the past is the past. Leave it there. And here are a couple of things that I wrote down with the Holy Spirit spoke to me when we're talking about past. Number one, the fact that he wants us to leave the past behind doesn't mean that we put it out of our mind or can't call it to our recollection of what happened in the days previous to knowing Christ. But the fact of the matter is the fact that we can't put that away. We struggle with transition. We struggle going from season to season. We struggle in the middle of the transition. And anybody who keeps up with sports at all, and my brother-in-law Adam will tell you this, and we talk all the time about the Hornets. Well, what are they going to do in the offseason? Who are they going to trade? Who are they going to get? Your offseason can make or break you. The times that you're in, maybe you're in a waiting season, maybe you're in a season, you don't really know what's going on, you're just waiting on God to open up a door, you're just waiting on God to answer the prayer, you're just waiting on God to reveal the victory, and in that off season, that can make or break you. Just like a team who goes out and they trade away or they bring in a certain person, it's going to change the chemistry of how the team works when they bring that person in or they send a person away. And anytime you're changing the chemistry, it's always an experiment trying to put it all back together and get it to where it needs to go so that you can see victory and have success when the season comes around. Be sure, Christian, that in your off season, you're not doing things that will set you up for failure when the season opens up for you to be doing what God has called you to do. Some of you might be in waiting today. Some of you might not know what your calling is. Some of you might not know where God's sending you next. Some of you have not gotten an answer yet. But the fact of the matter is that there will come a time where your life comes to a crossroad, and that answer will and can or can come, but it will only come based on the fact that you set up correct organization and structure in your life to make room for that blessing that God is sending. How many of you know that God is faithful? How many of you know that God is good? And we like to amen that. I got a lot of response there, but we don't get a lot of response when we talk about setting up structures and organizations to prepare for the blessing that God is sending our way. Because we do really good with knowing that God is faithful and the blessing is going to come, but the fact of the matter is that some of us get blessings that we don't have room for, and it ends up hurting us more than it helps us. And we enter then into another season where God is stretching us and teaching us things. And rather than it being an enjoyable experience and calling it favor, we say, oh, God's just stretching me right now. Oh, yeah, he gave me this blessing, but now we've got this popping up. And now we've got that popping up. And we've got a bunch of Christians that are breeding negativity and complaining in the midst of the blessing that God has given them. Need I remind you, like I did last week, that nothing you have is yours anyway. It's all his. And we will sit and we will complain about what we've been entrusted with rather than prepare and set up structures and organization in our life so that we can make room for the blessing of God that he's prepared for us. Because make no mistake, the blessing will come. If you're serving God, look, you can be serving God and not prepare correctly for a blessing that you're asking for. My mind goes to Waddy and Angie. I know you guys have seen some great successes in what you're doing. I don't mean to point you out. But you guys are doing great. But to get to where you're going, you have to set up the right structure and organization to do what you need to do efficiently and effectively, right? It's the same way in life. If I'm not preparing, I'm going to fail in the middle of even blessing that comes into my life. You have to be careful in the transition, not to, because you're in the holding pattern, not to continue working toward who God's called you to be. Because you've not fully come into what God has asked you to do, because you've not fully come into who God's asked you to be, you can't just stop working because you're not seeing the promise right now. As a matter of fact, right now is when you should be tilling the ground and preparing for rain and preparing and digging your ditches and preparing for the blessing of God to come into your life. The off season, in the transition, we struggle. Not only in transition, but we struggle, number two, with letting go. I should say 1B. I'm not quite there yet. It's all right. We struggle in transition, but we also struggle letting go. I have one thing under wraps, forgetting those things which are behind. We got a lot of people in here probably this morning that have pasts that haunt them. You've got memories that won't go away. You've got experiences that you will tell the church people, oh, but they shape who I am, but you're not willing to share them as part of your testimony because you haven't let them go yet. Do you see what's happening here? If the Bible tells me that I overcome him by the blood of the Lamb and the word of my testimony, and I say I believe in that, and I will share in fellowship with Christians and say, oh, I'm thankful for my past. I'm thankful for everything that happened to me because now I see it. And yet you go home at night and you cry yourself to sleep because that's the first time somebody's brought that up in about a year and a half, and you've been running from it, and it just reared its old ugly head again. Come on, somebody. We've all got a past that we've had to deal with. We've all got things in our lives that we've moved past and we're trying to move forward. But what the enemy does is he comes in because he knows we struggle with letting go. He knows we struggle with the release. And calling it to recollection does not mean holding on to it. But you need to be able to release whatever it was so that you can press forward to whatever it is that God has for you. If you can't let go of this, you can't take hold of that. You always have to go through this to get to that. Jesus had to go through the cross to get to glory. You and I are going to have to live this life and go through the fellowship of His suffering so that we can one day attain the resurrection. Sometimes you've got to go through offense to get to redemption. You've always got something to go through. And we have tasks and we struggle to let these things go. And here's the thing. Not only do we struggle in transition, not only do we struggle with letting go, but the past shouldn't be something of destruction. The past should be inspiration for now, not destruction for your future. I'm going to say that again because some of you didn't get it. Your past should be your inspiration for your right now, not your destruction for your future. Because here's what happens. When we begin to remember our past and we keep holding on to it, we end up getting stuck. But Jesus, He came to give life and life more abundant. I can't take hold of that life if I'm still holding on to the life that I used to have. The Bible tells me that I've been created a new creation in Him. The Bible tells me that when I come into who He is, I'm wrapped in the righteousness of Christ, and now I can approach boldly the throne room of grace. I couldn't do that in my old life. I couldn't approach Him in all of His holiness and all of His glory without the access code of Christ on my life. I cannot access the throne room of God. And we need to be careful, and I'm going to say this very delicately because I believe that there are Christians in here who are praying prayers that haven't been answered yet that still need to keep praying and pressing on. But there are some people in here who are praying prayers and living like the devil Monday through Saturday and expecting God to answer a prayer you're praying and getting the blessing while you go out and do whatever it is that you want to do. Curl your toes up. We've got to be careful not to believe certain teaching and theology, but not act on the things that we say that we believe. If I believe that God is going to bless me, I've got to act like I deserve a blessing. If I'm going to believe that God is going to send favor my way, I've got to act on my belief that God is faithful and He's good, and I want to model my life after who He is. I can't run around like a crazy fool Monday through Saturday and come in on Sunday and cry and say, oh, I just don't know what I'm going to do. I've been praying and God's not answering. And we're looking for the pastor. We're looking for the worship pastor. We're looking for the youth pastor. We're looking for any pastor or staff or any brother or sister that will tell everything is okay in the middle of our trials on Sundays. But Monday through Saturday, we're living a life that does not glorify God. And so their encouragement is in vain. And their investment in your life becomes nothing because we're not living according to the blessing that God has for us. And a pastor will encourage you because that's what they're called to do. But only you know what you do when you go home at night. Only you know what you do when you go home and you experience the struggles of what goes on in the day-to-day. And I'm not trying to cast condemnation on anybody, but I hope that I'm casting conviction on somebody so that they can come into who they are in Christ. I hope the Holy Spirit is getting a hold of somebody this morning. Because look, God has the blessing, but we have to look to the blesser and model my life after who He is. And if I can't let go of my past, if I fail in the transition, my life will end up stuck in the season that I want to forget. If I can't let go of what happened, if I can't let go of the experience, if I can't let go of the hurt, if I can't let go of the fight, if I can't let go of the argument, I will end up staying right where I am, and life will pass me by. But I'm still worried about the season that I want to forget instead of changing who I am for the future. Because the fact of the matter is, the life that you want is in front of you. It's in front of you. But it will cost you something. It's going to cost you something. When I was playing football, it costed me time, energy, and effort. I wanted to be a starter. It took me doing extra stuff, hours and hours, before and after practice. in the summertime before season even started. I was out on the field. I was doing what I was supposed to do. I was doing more than I was supposed to do. Why? Because I have to prepare for the kind of blessing that I want. The life that you want is in front of you, but it's going to cost you something. We like to use that old adage that freedom ain't free, right? Neither is blessing and favor. Neither is living a life for God. It's going to cost you something, not only to follow Jesus, but to go into the depths of His Spirit and find favor and blessing and grace and mercy that you need to do something great in your life for God. He says, I forget those things which are behind, and I reach forward to those things which are ahead. He didn't say, I forget those things which are behind, and because of that, Jesus brought everything I wanted to me. I didn't have to work anymore because Jesus saw my faithfulness, and He just saw me in my weakness, and He brought it to me. He said, I forget what's behind, and I reach, I strain, I push forward to those things which are ahead. What's ahead? Verse 14, it says this. I press toward the goal of the for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. What is it I'm pressing toward? I'm pressing to the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. The life that you have, that you want, is right in front of you, but you have to make an effort for it. But here's the thing. A lot of people are fighting for victory that they already have. You have to press forward. You have to press in. You have to reach forward and make an effort. And you have to draw close to God so that He'll draw close to you. You have to put it in. And you have to keep pushing. You've got to keep pounding. You've got to keep doing what it takes to move forward. But the fact of the matter is that you will never be able to do it on your own. That is why Jesus came, so that He could die on the cross, so that He could do what you couldn't do, so that you could live a life you could never have. That when He came, as you keep pressing forward, as you keep pounding through, as you keep pushing toward the upward call of Jesus Christ, God comes in, and where you're weak, He is strong, and He pushes you forward. And you're not going to attain victory on your own. But when you submit your life to Jesus, you've already won the victory. Our lives are a constant and progressive realization of the victory that's already been won. Our lives are a constant novel that's being unfolded before us. It's a constant story that's being unfolded before us to express and to convey the victory that Jesus won 2,000 years ago. He prepared and He set up structure and organization so that 2,000 years later, when the blessing came to your life, you would have room for it, that God would have room for it. Until Jesus came, salvation had not come. But through His ultimate and perfect plan, He set up what needed to be set up so that we might realize what it means to spend eternity with Him. We wouldn't have that blessing had Jesus not come. And in the middle of all of it, we would have failed. And there are times in your life that as you're going along, as you keep pushing forward, as you keep pounding through, as you keep pounding no matter what comes your way, there are things that you will approach that you don't know how to navigate around. There's something my dad likes to do when we're playing Madden on the Xbox. Yeah, I played it every now and then. Listen, my dad's always like, how do you call an audible? How do you do it? Because he'll see something and what I'm doing to try to stop him from scoring, that he wants to change, that he thinks if I change this, it'll be better for me in the long run. I'll be able to obtain what I'm going for if I can make this little switch, if I can change it, because I'm being presented with something that right now in my current posture, in my current perspective, I don't see a way to get around what's preventing me from victory. I don't see a way around to get to where I'm going, but if I change this one little thing, it'll open up a wide lane of favor and blessing. things so that I can get to where I'm trying to go. Y'all are not hearing me this morning. There are things in your life that you must change, that as you go, you must be flexible and adaptive, because the enemy will come in to steal, kill, and destroy. And he will throw things in your midst when you least expect it. And he will take the one thing down that you thought would always stand in your life. You have to be willing to call an audible in the middle of the situation to say, I'm going to do whatever it takes to get to where I know I need to go. I'm going to give God the glory in the middle of nothing making sense that he should get the glory for. I'm going to praise him when it doesn't make sense for me to praise him. I'm going to worship him, and I'm going to give him the most precious thing in my life when I feel like I have nothing left to give. I'm going to turn away friends that I need to turn away for a long time, because I realize now that I can't get to where I'm trying to go if I've got somebody trying to pull me back of where I just come out of. Hello? I'm going to let go of addictions because I realize now it's tearing my family apart. I'm going to release my past because I know every time I bring it up, my husband or my wife gets jealousy rise up in them when I talk about certain something that happened in my wife. I know it's touching somebody today. I'm going to let go of everything that happened to me in past seasons of my life so that I can strain toward what God's ahead of me. And if you don't remember what is ahead of you, it's a call of God. It's blessing. It's favor. It's abundance. He is good. His mercy endures forever. I can wake up every morning and have a new pot of mercy on the table for me. Goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And as I press forward, as I keep pounding, as I keep moving forward, I have a decision to make every time something comes into my life to tear me down, that I can keep going or I can lay down and quit in the season that I want to forget. As I was preparing this week, my mind went to another story. I often do this. I talked to you last week about Elisha. Now, Elijah came by and he threw his mantle on Elisha. As I was preparing this week, it's quite obvious probably to some of you, the first story that comes into your mind is a man named Job. We don't know who Job was. Job was a righteous man. Job was a good man. Job was a rich man. He was fortunate. He was favored. He was blessed. Job had everything that everybody could ever want, or that anybody could ever want. He was the man that everybody looked at, and they said, man, I wonder what it would be like to be him. The Bible calls him a favored man in the East. It tells that he was a rich man in the East. Job is the oldest recorded scripture that we have. Culture was a lot different then. Since that Job had some 3,000 oxen, some 7,000 camels, I believe, some 1,000 sheep. I might have got the numbers mixed up, but just know he had a lot. That's all that really matters here. More than people in his day and age would typically have. He was a fortunate man. And I want to tell you his story just real quick. I got a little bit of time left. But in Job chapter 1, the very first thing that we see about Job, and I think God did this on purpose, it said there was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job. And that man was blameless, and he was upright. He was one who feared God and turned away from evil. That's a pretty good man. There were born to him 7 sons and 3 daughters. He possessed 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 yoke of oxen. But that just means he had 1,000, because they yoke two together usually. And 500 female donkeys on top of that. And he had very many servants. So that this man was the greatest of all the people of the East. The sons used to go and hold a feast in the house of each one on his day, and they would send and invite their three sisters to eat and drink with them. And when the days of the feast had run their course, Job would send and consecrate him, and he would rise early in the morning and offer a burnt offerings according to the number of them all. For Job said, it may be that my children have sinned and cursed God in their hearts. Thus Job did this continually. He prayed for his family. He consecrated them unto God, that even in their ability to continue to blatantly sin against the God that Job believed in, he went and he prayed for his family and interceded on their behalf so that they might be counted as righteous before God. And verse 6 gives us a picture of eternity, and I love this story because I love pictures into eternity that I can't see always. But in verse 6, he says, now there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also came with them. The Lord said to Satan, from where have you come? Satan answered the Lord and said, from going to and fro on the earth and from walking up and down on it. And the Lord said to Satan, have you considered my servant Job? Don't you know that when you do something for God, he likes to brag on you? That there's none like him on the earth. A blameless and upright man who fears God and turns away from evil. And Satan answered the Lord and said, does Job fear God for no reason? Have you not put a hedge around him and his house and all that he has on every side? You've blessed the work of his hands, and his possessions have increased in the land. But stretch out your hand and touch all that he has, and he will curse you to your face. And the Lord said to Satan, behold, all that he has is in your hand. Only against him do not stretch out your hand. So Satan went out from the presence of the Lord. Now there was a day when his sons and daughters were eating and drinking wine in their oldest brother's house. And there came a messenger to Job and said, the oxen were plowing and the donkeys feeding beside them. And the Sabians fell upon them and took them and struck down the servants with the edge of the sword. And I alone have escaped to tell you. Verse 16, while he was yet speaking, there came another and said, the fire of God fell from heaven and burned up the sheep and the servants and consumed them, and I alone have escaped to tell you. And even more than that, while he was yet speaking, there came another and said, the Chaldeans formed three groups and made a raid on the camels and took them and struck them down, the servants with the edge of the sword, and I alone have escaped to tell you. It's looking pretty bad for Job. Now, verse 18, some of us would have given up already. While he was yet speaking, there came another and said, the sons and your daughters were eating and drinking wine in their oldest brother's house, and behold, a great wind came across the wilderness and struck the four corners of the house, and fell upon the young people, and they're dead. And I alone have escaped to tell you. And if you haven't quit by now, surely this would cause you to quit. They came. The Sabians struck down his servants that were tending to the oxen. They came, and his enemies, they struck down the camels and the donkeys. And then, natural disasters started to happen. See, some of us will throw our hands up and say, man, this universe is just out to get me at this point. And the fire of God fell, and it burned up the sheep and the servants with them. And not only that, but a big tornado came by and blew down the house of your oldest son. And it didn't just blow down the house. Bad news, Job, they didn't get out. They're dead in the house. So at this point, we've not even made it out of chapter 1 yet. And Job has lost everything that made him a great man in the East, in the sight of everybody who would have been in his culture in that day. You following me? He had lost everything. Everything that could have given him any sort of livelihood. His finances were gone. His food was gone. His property was gone. His sons and his daughters were gone. His promise was gone. His blessing was gone. He sat there and he realized he had nothing left to give. A man who every day and every night gave blessing and honor to God in his burnt offering sacrifice to consecrate his family, the ones that were doing wrong. And Job worked his whole life to provide for, but also he prayed for so that they would be blessed. Now it would seem that God has taken them away. How does that make sense, God? Some of you in here are sitting here just like Job, and you're going,
thought I'm doing everything I know to do.
I've submitted myself the best way that I know how. I've let go of everybody that I know, that I knew to try to push forward to a new life, and I feel alone. I've gotten rid of all my addictions. I've gotten rid of all the things that I do in the dark. I've gotten rid of everything that I'm going through that would tear me down. And I say, God, I'll trust you, but Lord, it's getting really hard because I just don't know if I can persevere anymore. I just don't know if I can do it. Verse 20, it says this. Then Job arose and tore his robe and shaved his head and fell on the ground, and he worshipped. In verse 21, Job surprises and appalls me and everybody who reads this story. And it says, and he said, naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked I'm going to return. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. But blessed be the name of the Lord. You see, Job had a realization that many of us fail in our whole life to take hold of. That the Lord has given what we have. And tomorrow you could wake up and it could all be taken away. Some of us would not be saying, blessed be the name of the Lord. Some of us would say, you know, I bought into what they were trying to tell me. They said he would bless me if I did it, and he didn't, so I gave up on him and I walked away. But I'll say what I said in the beginning, a Christ follower must have persistence and perseverance through moments of struggle to reveal the victory that God has already given you. Something that I always thought was just the coolest thing in a football game. I always thought it was so cool, and it was the epitome of what being a part of the team means when this happened. I didn't see that. Baby, will you come up here? Duncan, will you come help me, buddy? Can you come up here? You mind? You don't have to, but you can. Jose, will you come up here and help me? George? You guys get the word. Thanks, dude. Spread out. As I say, stay in a straight line. Stay in a straight line. You're not afraid of it. The coolest thing that I always thought that it epitomized what team sports is all about and what camaraderie was all about. I'm weird. I thought about stuff like that when I was in high school. Maybe a little deeper than a lot of the guys would have thought. But I always looked, if we were watching film or something like that after a game, I would watch a runner. Sometimes it would be me. And I'd be running, and there would be opposition come my way when she stepped close to me. And they would engage with me. And I would be engaged in this opposition that met me sometimes at the line of scrimmage. This happened especially close to when I was about to score, when I was about to get the victory, when I was about to get the points that I needed, when I was about to reach the goal, when I was about to reach my destination, when I was about to do what God called me to do, when I was about to do what He asked me to do, when I was about to obey and sacrifice, when I was about to do what I thought I should do. And it always happens that way, that when we get that close, opposition always meets us the strongest. Amen? Opposition always meets us the strongest. And I would be engaged in this opposition. But the coolest thing is my coaches taught me well enough to know that when I meet opposition, they used to have a saying that said, be the hammer and not the nail. Be the one that drives. Be the one that hits and not getting hit. Right? That was their saying. Be the hammer, not the nail. So I would engage. And I would engage low enough so that I knew when I engaged, I could extend past that first one. I want you to give me a little resistance and hang on to it. Grab my arm. And I would keep going. talk too much now. You're stronger than me. But I would keep driving my feet. Keep hanging on to me. Now, this person wouldn't let go. They wasn't letting go. And I would keep going. And I would meet somebody else. Grab hold of me, don't you? Don't hug me. Push me. Push me. Push me back. Push me back. There we go. And I would keep driving my feet. And another person would meet me in opposition and start pushing me. And you'd see me start to do this. And then the other person would see that I was in trouble. And they'd come to try to take me down. But here's what would happen. Run up here, Jared. Hurry. Hurry. I need help, Jared. Braxton, run up here. Run up here, Braxton. They would come behind me and they'd start pushing. They'd start helping. And they'd start pushing me toward the goal. Okay. And stay up here. And in the moment of my weakness, my brothers in battle would come and help me. I want y'all to stay up here. Hang on, don't go anywhere. Don't leave me. People crave this kind of stuff. Y'all are running to sit down. Come on now. And in the moment of my opposition, I found camaraderie and strength when I was weak. You get that? The strength when I was weak. Now, I was like, don't get that from here. Actually, y'all say where y'all were. And in essence, this is what happens with Jesus. As I'm walking my walk, everything's going good. I'm driving down the field. I'm right there. I can see the victory. I can see where I'm headed. I can see where I'm supposed to go. I can see what He told me. I can see the blessing. I can see the promise. I can see the covenant relationship. I can see the person He's got for me. I can see this. I can see that. But I've got all this stuff in the way. And I get down close to where I'm going, and all of a sudden, financial hardship begins to hit me. And I meet opposition, but I know I just got to trust God. And then what happens is my marriage starts to fall apart. And I'm starting to feel weak again. And then I get laid off of my job. And I just don't feel like I can do it anymore. And the enemy, he sees me in my struggle. And he comes in for the kill shot. But then Jesus comes in. Jesus comes in. And he starts giving me a push to help me push back the enemy to get to where I'm going to go. Don't you know that Jesus died to give you the victory that you could not get on your own? Jesus died to help you push through to the victory that you want to see in your life. And victory's already here. We just have to ask. One of the trademarks of our team was we had words to let our teammates know that we needed help when we were struggling. If we were tired, we'd throw our arm up. So, Coach, I'm tired. Here would come a sub, and he'd let us get off to the sideline. If we caught an interception, we had a word we'd say to let everybody know, turn around and start blocking because we're on offense all of a sudden. There would be times when we were pinned up back against the end zone and somebody picked the ball off and it turned around in our favor and they'd shout that word and the boys would go running. And God is waiting on somebody to shout a word of communication that tears down pride and says, God, I've done everything I know to do. God, I'm dreaming my feet. God, I'm trying to keep pounding, but I don't have the strength to do it on my own anymore. I need you to come to my rescue. And all He wants you to do is give a shout of praise, and He'll come running. All He wants you to do is still believe He's faithful, and He'll come running. All He wants you to do is He still wants to bless you, and He'll come running. Stand up on your feet and begin to give God some praise in this place. Hallelujah! You can do better than that. He's come to your rescue too many times. He's done too many miracles. He's been too good for you. Not to praise. Thank you, guys. Jesse, come up here for this.
I sent it just on a Facebook message last night. Isn't she wonderful? Isn't she wonderful? I love our church family. She agreed to do this with me this morning. She was on Facebook Live last night. It stirred my spirit what she was saying. And I say this all the time, that we overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. And her testimony last night really stirred my spirit. And I want to tell you something here in just a minute, but I want you to share kind of a version of what you were talking about.
Sorry, I'm not going to talk about people, but some people know, some people don't. We have been looking for a house since November. Our landlord is selling ours, so we have two. We've had houses lined up, six, seven, maybe even eight of them. But I have a pit bull, and that's like our big problem. I've had him for 6 years, and he's a big baby, and I have a letter from my doctor trying to let him stay with me. And then my husband got laid off in January on top of everything. So, a few weeks ago, I was at my mom's job to drop off a paper for some of my disability stuff, and I was calling DSS to check on stuff for food, because I went when he got laid off to try to get help for food, and it was 3 weeks, and he hadn't heard anything. And a woman that works with my mom was leaving to go home because she had just came back from having back surgery, and she was only working half days. And she overheard me talking and went and right then went to Food Line and got us a $25 gift card to Food Line for food. And also, a few days ago, I went to Walmart and was grocery shopping because the card came in finally. And one of my friends who isn't living right and hasn't been messaged me because I was supposed to watch her son to make some money, and she couldn't go to work because she was sick. But she said that after what was going on, I told her, and she said, "Well, I've been blessed lately, and so I want to come give you $100. And so I just started crying because I was like, $100 is a lot of money, you know, especially for young people and single people and single mothers and even families. And she came up there and gave it to me at Walmart, and I went to check out. And obviously, with the baby, it's hard, but I wasn't paying attention too much because I had WIC and food stamps and then I get detergent for clothes. And I went over $98, and she just gave me the $100. And God spoke to me in the shower last night, and he told me, he said, "What you're going through is not for you." He said, "You're straight. What I'm going through isn't for me, it's for the people that see me. They see how I live, and they think, well, she's always living right. And, you know, she goes to church every Sunday. She has her kid in church, and she's so strong. And where's her God now? Where is he when she's been looking for a house for 4 months? And he's getting turned down and turned down and turned down. And her husband, you know, the main provider, lost his job. And where's he now? And those two incidents, that's where my God's at. You know, that's where he's at. It might not be big, you know. Some people, and it's not for everybody to see, but it was enough to give me an encouragement for another day and to push a little further. And I believe that, like the pastor was saying, you know, you have to struggle yourself to be Christ-like. It says in the Bible, we're going to struggle too. And I believe in my heart that what I'm going through is going to bring my brother to Christ. And he's going to get saved. And my sister, they're going to get back in church, and then they're going to reach people, and they're going to open their eyes, all because I stay strong through everything. And because ultimately, that's what we're here for. We're here to be, you know, vessels of God, and to go through stuff so that they can see us go through and still push forward.
Can we give God a hand clap for praise for this goodness? Thank you, Jessica. And I want you to see something. Mama's standing right over here in the corner. She's right there. Support. She's there. Camaraderie. She's there. We're a family. As a church, we're here for one another. But I want you to tell you something, Jessica. When I got this sermon series put in my spirit, the Lord laid you specifically on my heart, and he said, "I want you to let her tell her testimony." This was 4 weeks ago. And I struggled not to bring you up here 2 weeks ago, or last week, because I was like, "Okay, this would be great, God, this is wonderful." And he said, "I don't want you to do it yet. But last night when I got on Facebook, and you started sharing what the Lord laid on your heart like that, He stirred in my spirit for you to share that today, because I believe that there's somebody in here. Doubt has gone far enough. Worry has gone far enough. Not knowing and not being able to trust God because you don't have control, it's gone far enough. And for somebody this morning, it's time for you to let go and let God. For somebody in here this morning, be encouraged because you're not the only one going through it. There is power in testimony. And I stand in opposition today to the devil that would tell you that everything that you've been told is a lie. I stand in opposition and I rebuke the tactic of the enemy that would tell this church family that they can't make it, that they can't do it, that they're not strong enough, that they're not good enough, that their God will not come through for them. I stand in opposition today. Would you lift your hands all over the house today? God, in the name of Jesus, let every hand be lifted as a sign. Let it be lifted as a sign of receiving today, God. A sign of surrender that turns and reaps a reception of your blessing and your glory today. God, let this be a sign and a symbol to say, God, I'm ready and willing to do whatever it takes. And no matter what comes my way, I'm going to keep pounding. No matter what comes my way, I'm going to keep pushing. No matter what comes my way, I'm going to trust in you. Oh, come on, somebody, and worship him right now in this moment. Just begin to call out to him your needs. Just begin to call out to him and tell him you trust him with whatever it is. Begin to, come on, am I in a Pentecostal church today or what? Somebody cry out to the Savior today. Somebody call out to the King of Kings and to the Lord of Lords today. Come on, worship, worship, worship. Pray, pray, pray. In this moment, if this message was for you today and you said, Pastor, I'm going through a ton of stuff and I feel so weighed down and I don't know how to get out, I want you to come and find a place in this altar right now. While the Spirit is moving, while the waters are troubled, I want you to come up here and I want you to get your blessing from God. It's not in a man. It's not in anything. It's in the Spirit of the living God. This is your moment. You can make the decision right now to have your moment with Jesus, or you can sit back and be stuck where you have been for years, for months, maybe even just a couple of days. But right now is your moment to come and experience the Master, to come and experience the author and the finisher of my faith. I need some prayer warriors. I got some that are in the altar. I'm going to wait for just a moment because I know there are more people that need to come. If this is you this morning, I want you to come on and fill these altars. I want you to come and find a place. Don't let the moment pass you by. I still need prayer warriors. I still need people who are going to pray. They're still coming. They're still coming. They're still coming. I need prayer warriors. I need people who are going to pray. Come on. If this is not for you, come and be for somebody. If you're not pushing, come help somebody push. If you're not pounding, come and help somebody keep pounding. I still need prayer warriors. I still need prayer warriors. Come on. Anybody else today? This is your moment. You are engaged in resistance. You're engaged in a tactic of the enemy to try to tear you down. And this is the moment you push through. This is your opportunity to push through. I'm going to hang out for just one more moment. I believe God wants to do something right here. I believe God wants to do something miraculous for somebody today. If this is for you, come and find a place. Don't let fear creep in. Don't let doubt creep in. Don't let worry creep in. Everybody's got something. Everybody's struggling with something. Don't let it pass you by. Thank you.
mercy. God, it's in your presence that things change. It's in your presence that people are delivered and people are getting suffering. God, I trust you today. I've preached the word that I've spent God, I trust you with results. I trust you with lives. God, they're submitting themselves to you this morning. And God, I trust you in the moments that we feel like giving up, that you would give us spirit, strength, to keep going. Keep moving, to keep fighting, to persist, to persevere, to be strong. That in the middle of sorrowful situations, that we trust that the joy of the Lord is our strength. God, we give you the glory today. God, we give you the glory. Sing this one time through with us in the presence of the Lord. So much for being here today. I hope you've made plans to stay with us afterwards to experience the fellowship. We're going to have hot dogs and hamburgers. We've got cornhole boards, as I understand it, and football to throw around. It's just going to be a good time. Nothing special or spectacular, but I just want to be with God's people having a good time, a celebration and fellowship. So I hope that you'll join us today. Free of charge, of course, where there should be some chips and drinks, and we've got it covered. So come and enjoy it. We love you so much, and thank you so much for being here. We hope that you'll join us on Wednesday night at 7 p.m. to continue our study on relationships. It's been a good one. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. God bless you as you go. We'll see you just after service.